Hi, this is Dr. Herndon. In this video, I'm going to be talking about principles of fluid therapy in animals. What happens to a patient that won't drink? What about the patient that's losing body fluids from vomiting, diarrhea, blood loss, or polyuria? How are we going to replace this patient's fluids? How can we calculate the fluid requirements for our patients? What are some different types of fluids used in veterinary medicine? These are just some of the questions that I hope to answer with this series of videos on fluid therapy. Fluid therapy is the cornerstone of good patient care. Uses or indications in veterinary medicine include treatment of acute hypotension or low blood pressure, such as occurs with shock or hemorrhage, treatment of dehydration, which often occurs in patients that have ongoing vomiting, diarrhea, or polyuria, managing electrolyte or acid-base disturbances that often occur with certain diseases, maintaining hydration and blood pressure in hospitalized sick patients. Fluid therapy is also used in order to administer medications in hospitalized patients or patients undergoing surgical procedures, or those that require ongoing administration of medications, treatment of toxins, or promoting urine output in animals with kidney disease, otherwise known as diuresis. In all cases of fluid therapy, the veterinarian is the one responsible for creating the fluid therapy plan, and the veterinary technician will institute that plan and monitor the patient. Keep in mind that fluid therapy is constantly monitored and continually reformulated according to the patient's needs. Now let's look at the body's water balance. Water is the key to our survival. The body is comprised of about 50 to 70% water, even higher in very young animals. This water is critical to proper cellular metabolism in the body. Sick animals, such as those not eating or drinking, or animals losing excess body water, such as with vomiting, diarrhea, or polyuria, need fluids replaced. Animals can live for weeks without food, but only a few days without water. When total body fluid losses are greater than fluid intake, the resulting fluid deficit becomes clinically apparent as dehydration. Now let's look at the distribution of body water. Approximately two-thirds of body water resides in the intracellular space, within the cells themselves, and about one-third resides in the extracellular spaces, which is then broken down into two compartments, the interstitial space or the intravascular space inside the blood vessels. If we break down the extracellular fluid distribution, we see that about three-quarters of that fluid is located in the interstitial space between the cells, and about a quarter of the fluid resides in the vascular space or in the blood plasma. The other fluid here refers to fluids in spaces such as pleural or peritoneal fluids. It's important to mention that body fluids move back and forth freely across these compartments via semi-permeable cell membranes. Also important to mention is that increases in total body fat will decrease the relative amount of total body water, and it's important to estimate a patient's fluid needs based on lean body mass as opposed to total body weight. Now let's look at water intake and water losses in the body. How does water get into the body? Normal sources of body water include that comes from drinking and eating, and water that results from normal metabolic processes in the body. Normal body water losses result from urination, water in feces, water loss through the lungs, either in regular respiration or excessively in panting in dogs, sweating, not for all species, but this is true for horses. There is a difference in the water losses. Some we can measure and some we cannot measure. A sensible loss of fluids is something that we could measure, such as urine. An insensible loss is fluid loss from the body that's not measurable. This would be something like respiratory water loss. Abnormal fluid loss results from vomiting, diarrhea, polyuria, hemorrhage, or fluid loss in body compartments, such as with ascites or effusions. When fluids are lost by any means from the body, this occurs in a specific order. Fluids are initially depleted from the intravascular space, and then secondarily from the interstitial space, and lastly from the intracellular space. The body's protective mechanism is to save cellular water until depletion rates are too great for compensation. Loss of intravascular fluid results in decreased tissue perfusion, with resulting tissue hypoxia and decreased clearance of toxins and wastes. Whole body fluid loss from the extravascular compartments results in clinical signs of dehydration in the patient. Okay, I need to define a few terms that are related to changes in body fluid volume. The first one is hypovolemia. That refers to a decrease in circulating fluid volume or decreased vascular space fluid. This is the fluid that's in the plasma. Dehydration refers to whole body fluid loss and will be assessed based on results of the physical exam and specific lab parameters. Hypervolemia refers to an excess of circulating fluid volume, such as occurs with iatrogenic fluid overload or us giving a patient too high of a rate of fluids, or something like heart disease where the body is not able to efficiently deal with the normal body fluids. Physical exam and laboratory findings will also help us assess changes in the fluid content of the body. The way that the fluids are lost from a body often gives us an indication of underlying electrolyte disorders or an indication of underlying acid-base disorders. However, blood work is going to be necessary to confirm these suspicions. Some of the common electrolytes are potassium, sodium, and chloride that we're looking at, and then, of course, bicarb when we're evaluating acid-base status of the patient. We can use charts such as this example from the Wanamaker and Massey Pharmacology textbook that gives us examples of different medical conditions in animals and the expected changes in electrolytes, bicarb, and total fluid volumes. The last column contains suggested replacement fluids that we may use in these patients. In evaluating a patient for fluid therapy requirements, we take into consideration the patient's history, which may give us an indication into the type of fluid losses and the duration of these losses, the chief complaint by the owner, of course, and then the results of our physical exam. This is going to give us an idea of the need for additional testing, such as lab work, and help guide us in determining a fluid therapy plan for the patient. When evaluating a patient's hydration status, keep in mind that shock or hemorrhage will occur quickly and will cause hypovolemia and a resulting drop in blood pressure. Signs in most species include tachycardia, though we sometimes see bradycardia in cats, delayed capillary refill time, pale mucous membranes, dull mental state, and weak or even absent pulses. Severe shock or severe blood loss will decrease circulating oxygen levels with resulting organ failure, brain damage, coma, and possibly death. Dehydration, on the other hand, occurs more slowly in a patient and takes longer to correct with fluid therapy as a result. The history, physical exam, and lab work will help us assess a patient that's dehydrated, though keep in mind that the determination of the percentage dehydration is subjective, and signs of dehydration will not occur until a patient is about 5% dehydrated. When assessing a patient's hydration status in our physical exam, we're looking at skin turgor, mucous membranes, eyes, heart rate, and pulses. Charts such as this one are used to subjectively determine a patient's percentage of dehydration based on the changes in skin turgor or the increasing loss of skin elasticity, decreasing amounts of mucous membrane moisture, increasing capillary refill time, changes in the appearance of the eyes, either sunken back into the head or dry appearing cornea, and changes in the heart rate and the pulse quality. When assessing hydration in our patients, simple lab tests are very helpful. packed cell volume, or the PCV, and the total plasma protein can be quickly performed and require only a few drops of blood. A combination of an increase in total protein and an increase in the PCV suggests intravascular dehydration. Keep in mind that pre-existing anemia may alter the results by changing the number of red blood cells, so it's recommended to always test the total protein concurrently with the PCV. A urinalysis will show an elevation in the urine-specific gravity in a dehydrated patient, though patients with underlying kidney disease that are causing the fluid deficits or the dehydration may have a lower urine-specific gravity, which may indicate the cause of the dehydration in the first place. This concludes my overview on the introduction to fluid therapy. Please take the quiz on Canvas, and I will continue my discussion on fluid therapy in the next video in this series. Thanks!